and after the awful row between them. She hadn't elaborated on what the row was about, but her eyes misted with tears when she was talking. She'd had to find somewhere to live after their tied cottage was needed by the young man and his family who replaced him. She'd earned enough at Kevin Court to afford a two-up, two-down terrace next to the corner shop in the village. Mother had kept her on as one of the housekeepers once she wasn't needed as my nanny. "I don't know what I would have done without Nanny M, Clara," my mother had said. "She was here to take over when that awful telegram arrived about Edmund. I don't know who was the more distraught, her or me. You were just a baby, and she made sure you were her priority. No matter how much I withdrew into my shell, she never gave up on me. In the end, she got me back to health. And then again, when your father passed away." I often reflected on those words. And here Nanny M was again, sorting out another Price family problem. Chapter 32. Even though in the eyes of the law I didn't have to leave straight away, I couldn't bear to stay. So certain that the second will would be proved valid, my departure was my uncle's opportunity to move into the court. Moving to the village went as smoothly as it could have done. It was obvious my uncle would be successful, so why prolong the agony? He was already making his presence felt. His instructions made it clear that no belongings from the house were to be removed. I did, however, take personal papers belonging to my mother and ask the current groom to fetch my beloved rocking horse and take it to Em's. Mother had always told me that she'd bought it for Marjorie before she was born, and because I reminded her of the daughter she lost, I was to call it my own. It seemed to me to be a bond to the sister I never knew, and I was sure that the occasional spontaneous rocking in the middle of the night was Marjorie, letting me know she was there.